Okay, good morning, everyone. Very happy to welcome you to the press conference of the International Narcotics Control Board and to the presentation of its annual 2016 report. The president of the INCB, Mr. Werner Sipp, is going to present the report now and is afterwards at your disposal for questions. Just something that I want to point out already, we will be recording the audio, so I would ask you to use the microphone, even though you might think it's not necessary afterwards when asking questions. And with this, I'll hand the word to Mr. Sipp.
Thank you, Mr. Seckler. Welcome to this press conference and the presentation of the INCB Annual Report 2016. I'm Werner Sipp. I'm the president of the International Narcotic Control Board. And what we are doing here is the main launch of our report. It will be launched and presented in many countries, in many capitals around about the world. And as this is the main launch, I make this press conference and this presentation in English. It will be seen everywhere around the globe. So, welcome to this press conference. With me today is Mr. Fingerhut, the Secretary of the Board, and Mr. Seckler, Michael Seckler, from the United Nations Regional Information Center. And I'm very grateful to the Bundespresseamt for the hosting of the event. Let me first introduce very shortly the International Narcotic Control Board, the INCB. The INCB is an independent body mandated to monitor the implementation of the three international drug control conventions. Every year, the board publishes annual reports which provide an overview over the functioning of the international drug control system and the global drug control situation. They also identify shortcomings in implementation of the conventions. You had all access to the embargoed report and the press material, and you have seen that our report covers a huge number of issues. As you have already had the opportunity to study the materials, I will try to keep my introduction brief in order to provide more time for discussion. The most important event during the last year was the United Nations General Assembly special session on the world drug problem in April 2016, the so-called UNGAS 2016. In its outcome document, all governments reaffirmed their commitment to the implementation of the international drug control treaties. The treaties are the basis of international cooperation in drug control. The objective of the drug control system is to ensuring the availability of narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances for medical and scientific purposes, while preventing illicit drug crop cultivation and production, trafficking and abuse, and diversion of medicines to abuse. We are convinced that the treaties, together with the UNGAS outcome document, provide a modern and flexible framework to meet the world's drug control needs, if they are implemented in the right way. As every year, our annual report contains four chapters. Chapter one is dealing with the general topic, which is this year, women and drugs. Chapter two, the functioning of the international drug control system. Chapter 3 is an analysis of the world drug situation, and Chapter 4 contains recommendations. I will go straight to our Chapter 1 on women and drugs. This chapter refers particularly to the Sustainable Development Goal number 5, which is achieving gender equality and empowering all women and girls. Our report calls upon governments to pay more attention to gender specificities and complexities in the design and implementation of drug policy. Our report shows that effective and comprehensive drug policies must address the needs of women and remove obstacles which prevent them from accessing health care and treatment services. Currently, this is not the case. Despite the fact that women represent one-third of drug users globally, but only one-fifth of drug treatment recipients, women are significantly more likely than men to be prescribed narcotics and anti-anxiety medications. Women have been affected by a disproportionate increase in drug overdoses, and women are increasingly being arrested for drug-related crimes. Drug-related harms impacting on women have consequences for their families and communities, particularly their children. Often these impacts are not adequately taken into account. Gender-specific drug abuse prevention and drug dependence treatment, where they exist, are often underfunded and underdeveloped. We hope that our chapter on women and drugs will serve to change perceptions and remind policymakers of the importance of giving more attention to the specific situations and needs of women. Drugs policy must protect the right of women who use drugs or who have committed drug-related offenses, as well as the rights of their families. In the conclusion of our chapter one, we call on all governments, first, to collect data disaggregated by age, sex, and other relevant factors to allow for better informed policies and the more efficient allocation of resources. To provide for prevention programs that target women, especially those at particular risk. To prioritize access to healthcare for drug-dependent women, including for drug-dependent women who are pregnant. To ensure safety and privacy in treatment facilities for women. And to give high priority to eliminating the stigma associated with drug dependence, including among women. I come to chapter two of our annual report. In this chapter, we review the functioning of the international drug control system. With this system, we monitor the licit trade in narcotic drugs, psychotropic substances, and precursor chemicals, with the aim to ensure the availability of internationally controlled substances for medical purposes, and to prevent the diversion of controlled substances into illicit channels, as well as the illicit cultivation, production and manufacture, trafficking and abuse of narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances. Essential to this objective is government compliance with their reporting obligations under the conventions. We highlight that reporting is often deficient. To assist governments, we have launched in early 2016 a project to improve their capacity in this field, so-called INCB learning. Also in chapter two, we reviewed the drug control situation in selected countries, and we report on our country missions. Last year, we conducted missions to some 13 countries. In our dialogue with governments, we have always to respect the confidentiality requested by the treaties. In chapter two, we also review the situation in Afghanistan, a country that we visited last year and with whose government we hold ongoing and intensive consultations. INCB is extremely concerned about the general situation and the drug control situation in the country. In our report, we call upon partner governments and the international community to sustain their support for counter-narcotic efforts in Afghanistan. And we call upon the government of Afghanistan to show that substantial, sustainable, measurable, and demonstrable progress is being achieved in countering drug trafficking. Indeed, we state that sustainable development, security, and stability will only be achieved if drug control is improved. Moreover, chapter two contains a number of so-called special topics. The special topic of state responses to drug-related offenses emphasizes the fundamental principles underpinning the international drug control treaties, which are the principle of proportionality, the principle of a balanced approach, and the respect for human rights. We note and welcome the evolution in many states from a drug policy rooted primarily in punitive criminal justice towards a policy recognizing drug use and dependency as a public health concern. Regrettably, however, many states continue to address drug-related offenses primarily through punitive criminal justice measures that include prosecution and incarceration, even for possession of small quantities of personal use. Consequently, available alternative measures such as education, treatment, rehabilitation, and social integration, which are set out in all the three conventions, remain underutilized. We emphasize that there is no obligation stemming from the conventions to imprison people who use drugs, who commit minor drug-related offenses. We also encourage states that retain capital punishment for drug-related offenses to consider the abolition of the death penalty for drug-related offenses. I will now come to the topic of extrajudicial treatment for suspected drug-related criminality. We note with great concern that in some countries, individuals suspected of involvement in drug-related activity, including drug use, have been subjected to violent acts of reprisal and murder. The board condemns categorically the extrajudicial targeting of such persons. We call upon all governments concerned to put an immediate stop to such actions and bring their instigators and perpetrators to justice. Another special topic on legalization and regulation of non-medical use of cannabis, we reiterate that the parties to the 1961 Convention have assumed the obligation to limit the production, trade, use, and possession of drugs exclusively to medical and scientific purposes. This rule does not permit any exception. This is also the case for cannabis. We are in dialogue with the states that have already adopted measures, like the USA, some states in the USA and Uruguay, or who are considering measures, like Canada, which allow the non-medical use of cannabis and the creation of a regulated market. We reaffirm that such measures are incompatible with their legal obligations under the 61 Convention. State parties now have to consider how to respond to those countries that disregard the treaties by permitting and regulating the non-medical use of drugs. I've already mentioned the importance of accurate and timely reporting by governments for the effectiveness of the international drug control system. In this slide 7, we show some of the reporting obligations. Regrettably, many governments fail to comply with this treaty obligation. We highlight weaknesses, offer assistance, and make recommendations in this regard. We urge all governments to empower their competent national authorities with the means to facilitate licit trade, to ensure access to and availability of controlled substances for medical use, and to prevent diversion. It's imperative that governments provide training for their healthcare workers to prescribe responsibly and rationally, and empower responsible officials to estimate their needs for medicines accurately. Last year, by the way, we dedicated a full special report to the topic of availability and access to medicines. Another special topic is devoted to our electronic tools we have developed to help governments meet their obligations. But I will not delve into this, but take your questions later. In our report, we have explained our view on the operation of so-called drug consumption rooms. We reiterate that the ultimate objective of such measures must be to effectively reduce the adverse consequences of drug abuse, that they must not condone or encourage drug abuse or drug trafficking, and that such facilities must be operated within a framework that offers referral of patients to treatment, rehabilitation, and social reintegration measures. We find that in paragraphs 174 and 720. I now come to the chapter 3, the world drug situation. Chapter 3 covers our analysis of the world situation region by region. I will be very brief, but we'll be happy to take your questions afterwards. Africa. In Africa, access to essential medicines remains limited. The region is affected by drug trafficking and is increasingly becoming a consumer market. Central America and the Caribbean. 87% of the cocaine entering in the United States was trafficked through Central America and Mexico, and about 13% through the Caribbean. South America, in South America, there are concerns over rising levels of abuse of synthetic drugs among young people. INCB congratulates the government of Colombia on reaching a peace agreement with the Revolutionary Armed Force of Colombia, FARC. We expect and hope that this development will have a positive impact on illicit drug cultivation and production, as well as trafficking. North America. In Canada and the United States, accidental overdose deaths, mainly from fentanyl-laced drugs, present a major public health challenge. Overdose deaths in the United States almost doubled between 2013 and 2014, and the number of people reporting heroin use nearly tripled from 2007 to 2014. Of the more than 47,000 drug overdose deaths in the United States in 2014, opioids killed more than 28,000 people. The government of Canada confirmed its intention to legalize and regulate the non-medical use of cannabis through new legislation to be introduced in 2017. We have indicated that such measures will bring Canada into conflict with its treaty obligation. Asia. In West Asia, the wide availability and abuse of fake Captagon tablets containing amphetamine is an issue of concern. Large-scale seizures have been reported in Lebanon and Turkey. Illicit opium production is once again rising in Afghanistan, where methamphetamine manufacture and abuse is also increasing. South Asia has seen increases in heroin trafficking, with the amount of heroin seized in Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and India increasing. Methamphetamine manufacture and trafficking has also increased. East and Southeast Asia remains affected by illicit opiate production and trafficking. New psychoactive substances continue to make inroads. Manufacture, trafficking, and abuse of methamphetamine have expanded. In the European region, we have seen an increase in the availability of cocaine. Ecstasy is once again more widely available. New psychoactive substances have continued to emerge. By May 2016, the European Union had identified more than 560 new psychoactive substances. 100 new psychoactive substances were reported for the first time in 2015. In the Oceania region, Australia reported a record amount of 12.6 tons of amphetamine-type stimulants were seized. In New Zealand, the quantity of methamphetamine seized more than tripled from 2014 to 2015. Data from the island states in the region is very poor. We call on governments of the region to step up their efforts to improve the collection of data on drug abuse and treatment, and invite the international community to provide support to this end. We also are launching today our report on Article 12 of the 88 Convention, also known as the INCB Report on Precursors for 2016. The report covers action taken by governments and INCB, the extent of illicit trade in precursors and the latest trends in precursor trafficking, and the role of law enforcement in preventing diversion to illicit channels. It highlights the achievements in the monitoring of legitimate international trade in precursor chemicals and the successes achieved when governments work together, share information, and engage in joint actions. The report highlights government commitment to include in their monitoring efforts the so-called pre-precursors, substitute and alternative precursors and chemicals used in the illicit manufacture of drugs. The Precursors Report recommendations call for better information sharing and multilateral cooperation among governments improvements for control at the national level, and for better use of existing tools to identify, disrupt, and dismantle organized criminal groups involved in precursor trafficking. Our annual report contains, in the final chapter 4, a number of recommendations made to governments, to the United Nations and other relevant international national organizations. Firstly, we encourage the development of implementation and funding of gender-sensitive drug policies, which I already mentioned. We stress the importance of implementing proportionate responses to drug-related offenses. Disproportionate responses to drug-related offenses undermine the aims of the conventions. We acknowledge that public safety and security are critical objectives for any government, yet their pursuit cannot be at the expense of the inherent dignity of the individual. We encourage states to consider alternatives to convictions for minor drug-related offenses through education, treatment, aftercare, rehabilitation, and social reintegration. With regards to ensuring the availability of access to controlled substances for medical and scientific purposes, we urge all governments to fully implement the operational recommendations contained in the outcome document of UNGAS 2016 and the recommendations contained in our special report of last year on the subject. We emphasize again the importance of data collection and data sharing for the effectiveness and efficiency of the international drug control system. So I thank you. Now I just want to say the INCB takes note of the continued commitment of all governments to the drug control treaties, as reaffirmed at the special session of the United Nations Assembly in 2016, and looks forward to continued cooperation with governments toward improved implementation of the treaties. Well, I now look forward to your questions and thank you for your attention.
I have a question, just bring you the microphone.
Jetzt auch zum Schluss diese gendersensible Drogenpolitik, dass Sie die empfehlen würden. Was verstehen Sie darunter, also ganz konkret? Was muss sich konkret ändern?
Zunächst müssen Regierungen in der ganzen Welt mehr Klarheit haben über die Situation von Frauen, die abhängig sind, Drogen nehmen oder auch wegen drogenbezogener Delikte verfolgt werden. Die Situation ist in vielen Teilen der Welt überhaupt nicht klar. Wir brauchen sehr viel mehr gender disaggregated data, das heißt also aufgeschlüsselte Daten, die klar machen, welches die Position und die Lage von Frauen ist. Erst dann kann man auch vernünftige politische Maßnahmen in Erwägung ziehen. Wir stellen fest in unserem Report, dass der Anteil von Frauen an Behandlungsprogrammen erheblich geringer ist als ihr Anteil an Drogenabhängigen insgesamt. Das bedeutet, dass man den Zugang von Frauen verbessern muss. Da muss man überlegen, welches die Hindernisse sind für Frauen. Es gibt eine ganze Reihe von Hindernissen. Hindernisse, die sind auch unterschiedlich in den verschiedenen Regionen. Aber Hindernisse können Gründe haben in strukturellen, in sozialen Gründen. Sie können in religiösen, in einer ganzen Reihe von verschiedenen, auf verschiedenen Ebenen begründet sein. Und je nachdem muss man auf diesen verschiedenen Ebenen auch Aktionen machen. Nehmen wir an, beispielsweise auch in Europa zum Beispiel gibt es noch zu wenig Einrichtungen, die spezielle Behandlungsmodelle entwickeln und durchführen für Frauen. Es ist oft so, dass Frauen sich davon abhalten lassen, sich einer Behandlung zu unterziehen, weil sie nicht wollen, dass sie mit Männern zusammen behandelt werden. Aus manchmal durchaus verständlichen Gründen. Also brauchen wir gezielte Einrichtungen, die das machen. Wir müssen auch zum Beispiel dafür ganz banale Dinge dafür versuchen zu ordnen, dass eine Frau manchmal auch keine Behandlung eingehen kann, weil sie keine Kinderbetreuung hat. Es gibt sehr viele, aber viel wichtiger sind die grundsätzlichen Hindernisse, die sich stellen. Das Stigma, das verbunden ist mit der Drogenabhängigkeit. Und Stigma abzubauen ist natürlich ein ganz langer und ganz schwieriger Prozess, weil ein Stigma ist immer begründet in kulturellen Auffassungen, Vorstellungen, manchmal auch in religiösen. Die Lage der Frauen im islamischen Kulturkreis ist natürlich eine ganz andere, und daraus ergeben sich wiederum andere Hindernisse für Frauen, nachzufragen nach Behandlung. Das ist jetzt nur noch mal das Thema Behandlung. Aber ein anderes Thema ist, wie verhält man sich zu Frauen oder wie behandelt man Frauen, wenn sie sich strafbar gemacht haben? Auch da sagen wir, geben die Konventionen durchaus Handhabe, da sehr viel flexibler zu agieren. Wir haben beispielsweise in Europa, das zeigt unser Bericht, in Europa unter den Gefangenen, den weiblichen Gefangenen in den Gefängnissen, einen Anteil von 25%, die im Gefängnis sind wegen drogenbezogener Delikte. In Lateinamerika ist dieser Anteil 60-70%. Daraus kann man zumindest einen Schluss ziehen, dass dort von der Möglichkeit nicht genügend Gebrauch gemacht wird, die in allen drei Konventionen drinsteht, dass man nämlich anstelle von Bestrafung und Verurteilung Alternativen anwenden kann. Und zwar bei geringfügigeren Delikten. Und dass man dabei natürlich auch die ganz persönliche Situation und die besondere Situation von Frauen berücksichtigen muss. Das sind jetzt nur so ein paar Beispiele, aber wir haben in unserem Bericht eine ganze Reihe anderer Punkte angeführt. Aber ich sage nochmal, wir können keine konkreten Maßnahmen vorschlagen, weil die in jedem Land und in jeder Region wieder anders aussehen müssen. Was wir tun wollen und auf jeden Fall erreichen wollen, ist ein verschärftes Bewusstsein für das Problem. Und wir wollen denjenigen, die entscheiden können in dem Gesundheitsbereich und in dem Drogenbereich, aber auch den gesellschaftlichen Kräften, denen wollen wir ans Herz legen, hier nicht nur das Problem deutlicher zu sehen, sondern eben auch Maßnahmen zu ergreifen, um diese Situation zu verbessern. Also unser Appell an die Politiker, an die Politik und an die Gesellschaft ist eigentlich das Wesentliche unseres Kapitel 1, das kein wissenschaftliche Ausarbeitung ist. Wir haben zwar Wissenschaftler zu Rate gezogen, und Sie sehen, dass wir auch eine ganze Reihe von Fußnoten drin haben, in denen wir Bezug nehmen auf wissenschaftliche Erkenntnisse. Aber das ist nicht das Wesen unseres Kapitel 1. Wir wollen keine wissenschaftliche Arbeit liefern, sondern wir wollen einen politischen Appell auslösen an alle diejenigen, die von dieser Situation betroffen sind und die vor allem auch in der Lage sind, sie zu ändern.
Aber in Ihrem Bericht schreiben Sie ja auch für die Medikation, sprechen Sie ja auch die Medikamente an, dass Frauen sehr viel häufiger Psychopharmaka sind, das wahrscheinlich gegen Angst und so. Was kann man denn, also was empfehlen Sie denn da?
Sie kommen, glaube ich, vom Bundesärzteblatt, nicht?
Nein. Ärztezeitung.
Ach, von der Ärztezeitung. Egal. Aber Sie kommen jedenfalls aus genau dem Bereich, den wir hier ansprechen wollen, nämlich den Ärzten. Und da müssen wir appellieren an die Ärzte, eben auch ihre Verschreibungspraxis mal zu überprüfen und sich bewusst sein darüber, dass Frauen erstens häufiger nachfragen nach solchen Medikationen, aus ganz unterschiedlichen Gründen, die zum Teil auch wieder sozial begründet sind, aber auch von der Einstellung her. Und dass die Ärzte sich im Klaren darüber sehen, was es bedeutet, wenn man beispielsweise Beruhigungsmittel über einen langen Zeitraum verschreibt. Dass dann nämlich plötzlich oder sehr schnell auch Abhängigkeiten entstehen, die dann oft verschleiert werden, die man vielleicht nicht so einfach erkennt. Aber Da kann nur, im Grunde kann nur, können nur die medizinischen Berufe können dann helfen, weil die beobachten, verfolgen solche Personen und können dann gegebenenfalls auch einschreiten. Vor allem muss natürlich die Verschreibungspraxis bei den Ärzten, die muss einfach problembewusster werden.
Hello, I'm Christian Müller from Uruguay, Radio Oceano FM. I want to know, the report insists that the legalization in Uruguay is contrary to the conventions, and it says that the board will continue its dialogue with the government with the aim of promoting the compliance of the conventions. I want to know what kind of dialogue it will be. Do you expect from the government to repeal the law, or what are your expectations? And what are your expectations about the states in the United States that legalized cannabis?
Thank you for your question. Yes, I was in Uruguay. I made a mission just recently, and I talked to the Uruguayan government, and I was very, very clear about the fact that what they are doing, first, they showed me exactly their concept and their regulation. They showed me why they wanted to do that, and they showed me the aims what they are pursuing with this new legislation, which, by the way, had been implemented rather slowly, step by step, but cautiously. No doubt about that. But we told them that, might it be as it is, this is not in line with Article 4 of the Convention, because Article 4 is very clear, says that the states have the obligation to limit the production, trade in, consumption, possession of narcotic drugs to medical and scientific purposes. And there is no flexibility in this respect. So they know our position. I know their position. I was not hoping that they would abolish or take back their law, their legislation. But it's important that they now, in the implementation of their legislation, they know exactly that they are outside the conventions. And well, I saw that, for instance, in Uruguay, there's even a majority in the population which does not agree with this new legislation. So might be there is one day also a political change, and they will come back to regulations which are in conformity with the country. We cannot, as an INCB, we cannot oblige them or enforce our conventions. The only thing what we can do is to explain the content of the conventions and to recommend to the governments to fulfill and to comply with these obligations. That's all we can. And if this is not the case, but by the way, we have good contacts with the government of Uruguay. Not only I was there, but I met them every time in the UNGAS session in New York in last April, or I certainly will meet them during the CND next week. So we maintain the contact. And our dialogue is not only to tell them you are not in compliance with the treaties. We also want to know which is the impact of this legislation. For instance, which is the impact on consumption? Does consumption goes up? Does consumption go up? Or what's the impact on the black market? Does the black market disappear or not? How does it work with, you know, it's a very complicated system with you need licenses, for instance, for cultivation, or license to buy it at pharmacies. You need a license to cultivate them. So how does it work? Do really all the drug abusers ask for a license or not? So we want also to see very closely how this new legislation is implemented, knowing that it's outside the conventions. But this does not mean that we do not continue our dialogue.
And what about the United States?
But it's rather similar. We had many talks with the United States government, with the central government, because the difference to Uruguay is that in the United States you have currently four states which have this kind of legislation. And the tricky thing is that these four states are also in contradiction to the national law. So the federal government is in a very difficult conflict. It's an internal conflict, but it's also an international conflict. So we keep the dialogue, and I can assure you that we use any opportunity to discuss with this government. I was in Washington, and I had many meetings. They came two times to us, to Vienna. And there, the same thing is true for the United States. We want to know how does it work in this country, which is the result. For instance, how does the big business develop? Because in the United States, marketing cannabis is big business, and it has nothing to do with health, really nothing to do with health. So we want to see also the practical consequences coming out of these legislations, and this is the meaning of our continued dialogue.
Hi, I'm Daphne Rousseau from Agence France-Presse. I wanted to ask if you could know which are the countries who are maybe the most reluctant to keep up the dialogue with you on the issue of drugs. If we could have some example of countries who are a bit reluctant to keep up the dialogue.
I must say that we have, in general, excellent relationships to all governments. I don't know any government who would be reluctant to have a dialogue with us. At least in the two last years where I was president of INCB, I was always welcomed in a very friendly manner, and we had always very fruitful discussions. Normally when we go to on mission to government, we have some concerns. This is the normal reason why we go there. Because you must not forget that we have a continuous dialogue all over the year. The governments have to report a lot of things to INCB, enormous amounts, for instance, all what concerns the illicit trade in narcotic drugs, psychotropic substances, the estimates. They have to estimate the needs for next year. They have to report what they needed last year. They have to give us the details on the transactions, quarterly transactions. So we are in a constant dialogue with all governments. But we go to a country when we want to see on the spot what is going on, and when we have particular concerns. Let me just, I told you that we made 13 missions. Out of the 13 missions, I, as a president, made five. I was in China, I was in Uruguay, I was in Canada. So I went to all these places where we have, or the governments have, some problems, and we discussed it. And I didn't see any reluctance, not the slightest reluctance, not be that Uruguay, be that Canada, be that China, or any other country. I was in Myanmar, I don't know, I certainly forget some of them. But this is true, and I think we are looking forward to continue this really fruitful and open dialogue the last years. I think we must say, probably let me add something, that INCB was very present last year in the UNGAS 2016. We had a side event. We were present with a number of members of the board. And this contributed, certainly, to open the mind of many governments to see better what INCB does and what he wants to contribute to the international. And so I think that this UNGAS 2016, for us, for INCB, was very, very, very important event, because the dialogue with governments and the relationship to governments certainly has improved following this session.
Hi,
Any other remark, question? Please.
So I asked myself how this implementation of this difference or gender bias treatment of women could be done compared to men, because to me it's not really plausible to make a difference there.
But I don't agree with you. It is possible to make differences, and you must make differences. The first step is to acknowledge that there are differences in the reality, in the real life, concerning access to treatment, concerning the number of incarcerated women, and all these points which we try to explain. And then you must see whether you can implement very targeted measures. And this must be possible, and it is possible. By the way, you see that at least in Europe, in the last 20, 25 years, we have witnessed a sort of development of the public consciousness of the condition of women, which you can see in the fact that, for instance, even the governments devote much more energy, much more efforts to women's condition. I myself was one of the first responsibles in the 80s, to work for condition of women here in the German government. And this is a process which led not only in Germany, but in Europe in general, to a better knowledge of the situation of women, a better knowledge also of the discriminations which always exist, but we certainly have been reduced since then. Other countries and other regions are far away from this state of mind, and have really to walk forward, to step forward in this direction, but they must understand. So it's also, you know, a matter of the social consciousness and the social feeling in general. And what we are trying to do is to draw the attention to this specific situation and ask and call upon governments to do something.
Okay, I understand that, but my question was more, I mean, I agree with you that maybe there are certain factors that make women more vulnerable to this kind of problem, and therefore they need other laws or rules to be treated with. But how can we do this when there is a society that is under a certain law, or in one country there is a specific law on drugs, and how can we implement this law differently on women than on men? Because if someone possesses drugs, then we have specific laws and so on.
I don't think that is a matter of law. We do not request that laws are changed, or we do not need new laws. What we need is a new policy, practical measures. Let me take an example. We said in our report that there are some groups of women which are at particular risk. Let's take the pregnant women. Pregnant women are, for several reasons, under a particular risk. So what should we do? We should not change the law, but we should see that pregnant women need consultants, need assistance by a multi-sectorial assistance system. Not only those who advise a male normally, but they need more knowledge. So we encourage the health authorities to set up teams, multidisciplinary teams, which can help these women in their particular situation better than we have done until now. So this is one small example. We do not need new laws. I don't think so. But we need new measures and new policies and a new consciousness. It seems that I have no more question. So, well, I thank you all for your presence, for your interest, and for your questions. And, well, I conclude our press conference. Thank you very much, and have a nice day.